So, John, perhaps not surprisingly, as you've alluded to, assessment providers have been amongst the first to pick up on the use of the framework. Was that anticipated, do you think, when you published the framework 10 years ago?
I'm not sure whether it was anticipated. It could have been anticipated because that was really the basic driving force. So I think it's not surprising that that was the first exploitation that people could see for the framework.
Right.
And it arose from their own practical needs and considerations rather than from any conscious intention on the part of the people launching the framework.
And as you've already alluded to, the framework, and particularly the global scale in its sixth level version, has spilled out from Europe, as you might say, from Chile to China, and it's being widely referred to now. Some people might argue that sort of indicates that the CEFR has become too big for its boots and gone beyond what is good for the users. For example, it's a European concept being used in a non-European environment. What's your comment on that?
If it arouses interest in other parts of the world, in very different parts of the world, this is because of the perceived needs of the people there, and their belief that there is something which they can use. Yeah. It isn't the result of any imperialist ambitions.
Particularly due to the wider use now of the framework, some voices are becoming particularly critical, and they have perhaps highlighted, in their view, some aspects which they think are outdated perhaps, or not fully up to date in the ways that people think about teaching and learning. And others are particularly worried that the drivers are not needs felt by the profession, but drivers to do with political expediencies, governments and agencies, seeing the framework, particularly its scale, its global scale, as a way of developing policy. Was that anticipated, or is that within what you think is appropriate for the use of the framework?
I think it arises from need, again. And if this feeling of need for such an apparatus is there, the need for calibration is there, then in one way or another, that need should be met. I know that the whole question of equivalence of qualifications has been fraught for many, many years in many subjects, not simply in languages. Yes. And in fact, we were anxious not to provide the kind of dispute and infighting that some of these attempts have previously encountered, which have led to their failure.
And perhaps the whole endeavour, equivalency is difficult.
Yes.
I mean, that's what I find interesting.
One of the reasons for having a six-level system and not, say, a 20-level system or a decimal system where you can have a proficiency of 5.425 or something like that, was that I don't think that the phenomena themselves allow for the reduction of proficiency to a linear scale which can be calibrated in that degree of detail. And for that reason, one wants a relatively robust system with sufficient differentiation to make the statements meaningful, but not going beyond what can be reasonably said for such a global concept, for a large variety of learners under very different conditions. If it is overinterpreted, and if people try to use it for purposes which for which it's not suited, then I think that's their responsibility.
But the global scale is clearly very attractive as a way of scaling proficiency. But do you think because it's become so popular, it's brought with it the dangers of oversimplification you're referring to? People seeking easy answers to complex questions.
I don't
think
it's because the system is oversimplified, but the people then attempt to use it as a precision instrument, then for a variety of different reasons, the general scheme can't be used in that way. For one thing, for example, if one is talking about grammatical progression, I don't think one can go beyond what we did in the threshold level, which is to set out the various parameters in which, for different languages, that might be expressed. When it comes to what it is feasible to the ways in which it is feasible to organize grammatical progression is a matter for each language separately, and not for a general scheme.
Are you perhaps highlighting here one of the difficulties that people struggle with, perhaps, which is an underlying dilemma, one between the need for commonality, which makes it attractive and generalizable, and the need for specificity when it comes to applying the scheme and the framework to a particular context, and the tension between the general and the specific, perhaps, which exists, is not fully understood by some users?
I think when it comes to understanding, the basis of understanding is a close acquaintance with the facts. And I think that the first thing people need to do before they set about the criticism of the European framework and its use is first to read it, and read it with some care. And secondly, to see what the Council of Europe has said about its implementation. And particularly, I would like to see critics look carefully at the recommendation of the Committee of Ministers, which is what's CM Rec 20087. That is Resolution 7 of the Committee of Ministers in 2008.
That was an important document, I remember now, because it came out as a result of the Intergovernmental Forum, I think it was 2007, which actually reviewed a survey that has been conducted by the Council of Europe to look at the uses of and impacts of the CEFR in the period between 2001 and 2006-07. So it was actually basing its further recommendations on a heightened awareness of what actually had begun to happen. And I know that it had already been noted that the CEFR had become a powerful tool, both in policy making at national levels, and also had begun to be adopted by the European Union through the work of the Commission for projects such as the European Indicator of Language Competencies, now known as the Survey Line Project.
Well, it is not the first case in which ideas pioneered by the Council of Europe and accepted by member governments because it is non-mandatory, always non-mandatory and permissive, and which then leads to greater anxieties when it is taken up by the European Union, which has directive powers, mm-hmm. and which has much greater financial resources, where it can use, for example, for as a condition for access to those resources. Mm-hmm. These considerations, directive power and financial support, don't apply with the work of the Council of Europe itself.
I see.
But it is sometimes when it is taken up by, the ideas are taken up by other institutions that trouble comes. You may remember that the British government subscribed quite happily to the Council of Europe Convention mm-hmm. On social rights mm-hmm. and fought like anything against exactly the same things once they became part of the of the social chapter of the Treaty of Maastricht.
Mm-hmm. That particular document you refer to, the recommendation which came after the Intergovernmental Forum, I think is a very interesting document because it's also supported by a set of explanatory notes written for users, and particularly with policymakers and decision makers in mind. How was that document set out then? I think it's not well known to many people. Perhaps it ought to be more widely referred to.
Yes. Well, the recommendation itself does not require, because it can't, but it does recommend governments to link the professional qualifications that they control to the levels of the European framework. Mm-hmm. But more important than that, it does strongly recommend to member governments that if they do so, then in the conduct of tests and examinations leading to those qualifications, they must meet the accepted requirements of good international practice. Mm-hmm. In particular, that the objectives, criteria, and examining practices, marking schemes, syllabuses, mm-hmm. should be transparent.
Right.
They should be published and available to all the users, mm-hmm. to candidates, to those who prepare them for examination, and those who use the results of the examination, and also open to inspection by experts in the field.
Of course, this is a mentally important point to make, because before any forms of alignment can be brought forward and justified, whether I suppose it's a course book or an exam, some professional practices have to be in place to ensure that what it is that's been produced meets the requirements in ways that are suitable to the profession in question, so
yeah.
for pedagogic or assessment purposes. And thereafter, there are ways in which the practice can continue. So it's not a, in the case of exams, for example, producing an exam once and then benchmark it in some way to a framework is not very helpful. If you have to produce multiple versions of your examination every year and administer it in many, many different contexts. And I think, if I remember correctly, that document is very helpful, particularly in the explanatory notes, in pointing out the requirements for appropriate examination development and administration by directing readers towards the various codes of practice and standards documents which now exist to guide practitioners.